Welcome to Programming with Qt Widgets. In today's episode, we'll finally get to the code. I'm not going to show you the code yet, but I'll tell you all the APIs. And in the next episode, I promise I will actually implement a model. We now have all the building blocks for being able to create a model ourselves. In this episode, we'll start talking about list and table models, which are way, way simpler than the tree model. They could have been much simpler, as we discussed previously, if they weren't bound by the API of something capable of creating a tree. You need to subclass something, one of the model classes. And the obvious choices for a list and a table model is to subclass QAbstract list model or QAbstract table model. You could, of course, subclass their base class, which is QAbstract item model, but that would be a lot of extra work for no gain whatsoever. So what do we need to do? Once we've decided that we want to subclass one of these, well, we need to implement two methods. We need to implement rowCount and we need to implement data. And that's all. Really? That easy? It is even that easy, yes. And see, the cool thing about this is that now that we have the building blocks, we know what a Q model index is. And when we implement our rowCount, we know that this is a list model. List models, they are one-dimensional. So one dimension means that there is no columns, there is no parents, there's only rows. So row count, all I need to go is to ignore that Q model index that comes in. Just ignore it. Just say, okay, whatever, and return a row count. In a bit later episode, I'll tell you that ignoring is likely not the best idea. Because if I come to you and I say, hey, how many rows do you have underneath one of your elements in your list? What will you answer? You should be answering zero. Will QListView come and ask you that? Absolutely not. QListView is a very, very well-behaved view. But remember what I've hinted forward a few times. We have these proxy models, and proxy models, they might be broken. But there's an episode entirely on how you check your parameters. So for now, all I'll do is that I'll say, well, row count, that is how many rows I have in my data set. And the next one, data. Well, this time I need to look at both the model index and the role, because the model index is what tells me which row I'm interested in. So am I interested in row 0, 1, 2, 3, or whatever? That comes into my index as the method row. It also has column and it has parent, and I don't care about that because I'm still just a one-dimensional model. I need, and that's very important, to look at row. I'll tell you what happens if I forget about the row. Robert, can you help me? Can you just say USA every time I ask something? So first of all, my view will come to the model and it will say, what should the text be, that's the display role, on row 0?
USA.
Okay, USA, that's cool. It will also come and say, what should the foreground color be?
USA.
USA, that's a weird color. Okay, well, I'll see if I can convert that to a Q color. How about the background color?
USA.
Font?
USA.
What kind of font is USA? And eventually I'll come and say, how about check row?
USA.
I'll see if I can convert that into a Boolean, I think. Maybe. I likely can. And then I'll have checkboxes throughout all of my views. So do remember to add those or to check for that row. So why would you go through all that burden of implementing these two methods, couldn't you just use the QList widget and give it your data? I'm glad that you asked, and I'm glad to get the opportunity to go back and stress that point out. Remember, your model might be more dynamic. There might be elements added later on. Or even if the model is static, it's still a good separation of your business logic and the representation that you have a class that is representing the data, or at least that is cutting the data, slicing the data into rows in a way that the view would understand it. And having said that, let's have a look at what does it take to make your model editable.
One of the new thing is Rust. Oh, that's a lame joke, Jesper. Okay, so if you're interested in Rust, maybe you should take a training from one of our partners, Ferris System. Sign up now.
To make it editable, all you need to do is to add two more methods to your API. You need to implement a method called flags. And if you remember back, we already did talk about the flags method in when we talked about the widget versions. I think it was when we talked about the Qt widget. The flags method for each and every cell, it tells whether, or for each and every row in the setup of a list model, it tells whether that row, that cell in more general, should be selectable, should be editable, should be a drop target, should be a drag target, and so on. Or drag source, I guess it's called. And that's the flags method. So it takes an index, and you will look at that index, and then you return flags telling about that. And then the user double clicks on a cell. The view takes care of bringing up an appropriate delegate. We can customize that later in this series. I'll talk about delegates. But once the user have, for example, insert a new string or a new number, your code will be activated again. And this time it's the setData method. And the setData is given an index. That's the cell, or the row in this case here. It's given a value as a qvariant. And by the way, the data method before was also a qvariant. And if you have not in the freshest of your memory knowledge about qvariant, then at the end of this episode, do go and rewatch that episode where I talked about qvariant. And finally, it'll give you a role. So set data, where, what, and what role. And the what role is usually the edit role, unless you have implemented your own delegate and for some reason want to use another role for that. I did ask, or didn't I? I did not ask in this video series. I'll ask now, what is the advantage of model view? And if you read up on that, you will clearly say, well, one of the advantages is the separation between UI and business logic. And 5 points for that. And if you read on, you'll say, well, one of the cool thing about it is that you can actually have multiple views look on the same model. Yes, that is true. And sometimes you do actually have that. Not very often, but sometimes you do. Sometimes you have two different kind of views. So one view goes straight to the model, the other goes through a proxy model, and the proxy model somehow manipulates, possibly scales down the data in one way or the other. And therefore, once the data has changed, in one view, you double click on a cell, you change the data, but the other view needs to be told about that. And that's the last piece of crucial information if you implement your own setting of data, namely, you must emit the method dataChanged. dataChanged takes two variables, it takes two parameters, it takes the start index and the end index. Think of it as a region of that you have dragged out. Most often it just say dataChanged index, comma index, because, well, at least in the set data, because you only have one index in there. But in the general case, if your data changed because it came in from a network and you changed multiple data, in those situations, you of course also need to tell your view. And it's super important to get into a good habit of thinking signals whenever you implement something in model view, because many times it works without those signals. For example, if you have the set data and you just double click on a cell and you edit it, the view will know that it has changed and it will update. It will ask to repaint that cell. And if you only have one view, well, everything will work fine. But then much, much later, you'll add another view. Or at some point, the data will be changed from a network traffic or whatever that comes in that is not initiated by the view. And in those situations, if you do not have the habit of thinking, what signals, then you might end up with the UI not being updated because of a change. Data changes is one thing. Another thing is structural changes. Structural changes is if rows are added or columns are added or whole hierarchy are changed. Obviously, not with a list model, but in the general case. And when those things happen, you need especially to be careful about the signals. But before we get there, I just looked at my slide here. It says drag and drop support. So if your model should be supporting drag and drop, you can actually drag and drop items onto the list view or the table view or the tree view. And in those cases, it will call upon the model, insert row, remove row, or move row. I think there's an S version to each of these three and a non-S version to all of these three. Look up the API. And if you implement those, they are by default, there's nothing implemented. So if you drag something onto a view that has a model that do not implement those, then nothing will happen. But let's not talk more about drag and drop now. We have a dedicated module a bit later in this series here talking about drag and drop. But if the data changes, and let's just assume that the data changes because some user somewhere else in your network did some changes and you got a network connection saying, oh, by the way, now the data has changed. If the data has changed, just the data, then of course you need to emit the data change signal. But if it's a structural change, then you need to emit as two signals, one signal saying, hey, we are about to start changing the data here, and another one saying, well, the data has changed, but you cannot emit those signals yourself. And that's because, or they are made impossible for you to emit to make sure that you get it right. And the way you do it instead is that you, as it says here, if I'm about to insert some rows, I need to call a virtual method called beginInsertRows. It's what is the parent index here? If it was a tree model, there would be something there. And where does it start and where does it end? I can never remember these, so just do as I do all the time, look up what is these indexes. And now you'll do your insertion, and when you're done, you'll call int insert rows. And why do you need to do those? Well, remember we talked about in the previous episode, we talked about persistent model indexes, and these persistent model indexes, they need to know when something changes in the model. And that's exactly how they know. And of course, your code might also need to know. So you can, of course, also listen to the set of signals, rows about to be inserted and rows inserted, I believe they are called, which are not the signals that you will be emitting. You will instead do like this. And here is the full list of, I hope at least, the full list of begin and end. So begin and end, insert rows, remove rows, insert columns and remove columns. That's of course for the table and the tree version. Move rows and end move rows. And then there is a begin and end reset model. So if things really, really changes a lot, then it might be the easiest for you to just say begin reset model, end reset model. I've done that a couple of times and man, my coworkers hate me for that. especially when I do that on trees, because I can't be bothered figuring out all the different signals to emit, because when I do that on a tree, every information about which branch is open will be forgotten. So do not copy me on that one. Do your real homework and listen or emit the right signal. So call the right begin and end. I tried to seek remorse for my actions of just emitting begin and end reset and begin and end reset. And what I did was I recorded a video for Qt Widgets and More, where I implemented a proxy model that does it entirely and 100% correct. It actually turned into be two episodes of Qt Widgets and More because it's so much work. And we haven't talked about proxy models yet, but you can still see it. Watch the episode, because proxy models, as long as you remember, a proxy model really is just a model that sits between another model and a view, and it behaves like a model in the sense that it must implement all the virtual methods that you will implement if you implement a model yourself, and it will emit all the signals that a model is emitting. And the way that your proxy model will get information is by calling methods on the underlying method, just on the underlying model, just like a view would do. That's a link here to that episode, or the first of them, and then you can follow from there. And that's it for the signals. I don't think I'll talk much more about the signals, but do remember all the time, think signals, 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 because otherwise, eventually things will break in a way that might not be as easy to detect. You have a view. It doesn't entirely reflect the underlying data unless you move the cursor over it, because when the cursor comes over it, a repaint event comes in. The repaint event makes the view go to the model and ask for the data, and all of a sudden you have the right data. That is doable to debug, but not fun. So do remember signals, signals, signals. That was a bit about both tables and trees. But if you want to implement your tables, you'll have to implement two more methods on top of what you implemented with lists. You implemented row count, now you also need to implement column count. And the column count, as for the row count, takes a model index as a parameter. You don't need that for anything because you have a table, not a tree. And how many columns do you have? Well, maybe that is just 8. Maybe it's depending on your data structure, but usually relatively easy to get by. You also need your tables have headers. So unless you hide those headers, you better implement header data. And the header data takes 3 parameters. It takes the section, it takes the orientation, and when the orientation is horizontal, that means the header above the table and the section indicate which column. And if the orientation is vertical, that's what I was trying to say, then it means the row. And finally, it takes the row. Robert, can you say it 3 times in a row?
USA. USA.
Yes.
USA.
You do not want to answer that the font should be USA, so better test for that row too. Once you've implemented these things, you now have implemented a table model. And that table model is, you can possibly change things if you implemented the setData method, which of course now needs to be adapted slightly because it needs to look both at the row and the column. And that's about it. That's it for this episode. You did not see a single line of code besides those on the slides here. I will make up for that in the next episode, where I will start out with a very simple project, and I will add a model to that for displaying a table. Until next time, have a great time.